Welcome to the best episode yet.
We're in Silverstone in the UK.
We held the first ever World Championship race here.
This is kind of like the main site for the Cadillac Formula One team. The team principal sits here.
The book stops with me, but thanks for reminding me.
The heads of aero, the heads of design.
Do you feel a lot of pressure?
Massive.
It's the best job in the world, really.
Technical officer, Nick Chester.
This is where we prove out the strength of the full-size car park.
It's about to be loaded to 30 tons. That's a big bang. That was a big bang.
We figured the most illustrative way to actually narrow down that question of how do you build a Formula One car is to show you the place where it's getting built. Let's go check it out. Some of you also have been asking, who is this guy? My name's David. Nice to meet you all. When the team was announced, I texted all the people I knew at General Motors and was like, how do I tell this story? And it's this kind of dream come true as a fan of Formula One to be able to then go and tell a story of how an actual car and team is getting built from the ground up. All right, so that's what we're doing here. We're gonna start the tour in 3, 2.
Hi there.
Hello.
How's it going?
Yeah, good. How are you?
Good.
I did my first Drive to Survive thing. Yeah, so I did like thing, but there was like a bright light in my face, just like this one. And
that's cool.
Yeah, that was good. Cadillac F1 is this improbable start, taking on this impossible task. We're putting all these people together for the first time.
Hello everyone. It's a common psychological phenomenon where our perception of time speeds up when we're up against a deadline. And as most of you know, we're up against a number of deadlines.
This sport is so difficult. It's so hard. It's so competitive. My mission is to build the best racing team in the world. If we can do that, then the results follow.
This is the underdog story of a lifetime. The doubts are real. And that's going to make you push harder and dig deeper as we look to get results.
We're going to be racing with some of the best teams in the world. Their objective at the minute is to race, design, build Formula One cars. We're building factories as well.
I'm going to do a test.
Wait, that's number 8?
We have about 10 to 12 people starting on average a week.
Wow. I'm a babysitter. Yeah. I'm ready with a, if you misbehave.
We kind of, I think we have 4 buildings currently. We have 1134, we have 1136, and then we've got unit 15, and then we've got 1501.
Is it just crazy?
It's mental. There's so much to do. Everybody's really excited. We need to get a lot done in a very tight space of time.
Hey, Nick.
Oh,
how's it going?
Yeah, very good.
We've definitely never met. We didn't just have this conversation.
No, for sure.
Are you ready to show us around?
I am. So what you can see here is all aerodynamics. So this is a bit over 100 people. When I started, there was only 6 of us.
Why do you sit here in the aero space?
Because that's where most of the performance is generated.
When you're building a Formula One car, it's an incredibly creative process. You're designing something literally from scratch.
Aero defines the shape of the car, and then design turns that into full-size parts. Vehicle performance decide then how the best way to sort of optimize the setup. But really the fundamental performance of the car is aerodynamics. So do you want to, we can have a run through the design office? You know, we're really lucky because we've not just got a design office here, we've got designers in Charlotte as well.
And there's John and Rob, right?
I'm John McWilliam. I'm the chief designer at Cadillac Formula One.
I'm Rob Stubbings, deputy chief designer.
There's no magic in Formula One. We deal with the laws of physics.
You start with the technical regulations, so mostly we either have to be inside or outside all of those boxes that the FIA have decreed. On the current regulations, a Formula One car is going to look like that with radiuses on it.
I know to you guys it probably seems like a 10% finished car, but to me that looks like a race car.
Still 10% finished at the moment, but.
Right, I think we can go through here. In a few months, we'll actually be building the first car here. You know, it's going to be so exciting when you've got
the chassis here and you're starting to assemble the suspension on it. It's very soon, yeah. There's a lot to do before then. So this is inspection. It's where we understand if we've got the quality we want in the parts or, you know, or if we need to do any reworks.
Basically down to the millimeter. It's
much, much finer than the millimeter. Some of it can be down to microns. Spot on. Thank you.
You're welcome.
This is our main stores. All the car parts will be marshalled in stalls. Every nut, bolt, O-ring, everything comes in here. We can really control the quality of everything going to the car that way. Okay. So there probably won't be anything much to see there for where we're going to build the car because it's just panelled off at the moment.
Somewhere in this area, the car will be assembled and fired up for the first time. We're over here. I don't know if I'm allowed to be showing you this.
So how do you actually start building the car? How do you start making the parts? Where does that happen? That happens in Building 15, and we're going to talk to
Patrick Horton, the ADM manager here at Cadillac. ADM stands for Advanced Digital Manufacturing, most commonly known as 3D printing. We are heavily aero-biased, so we are manufacturing parts for the wind tunnel model, a scale model, so 60% scale model. Colin, can I get that turned off a minute? Is that right? Sorry. When we finish with these, we send them to our model shop, then they get shipped to Germany, and then they're part of a wind tunnel testing schedule. The feedback from them will then define the next bits that get issued to us, and we print them, and the cycle continues, and it doesn't end.
This is by far the coolest room we've seen so far.
This is like what we've been waiting for, secret stuff.
Nadia, are we allowed to show them this?
I would say no.
Okay. We'll blur it.
We make the 60% scale model that runs in the wind tunnel.
So this is the barge board. This goes on the side of the model. We prep them, we put the steel rods in here.
Probably spend a month doing the internals, so that's the spine, the electronics, the pressure tubes.
And that'll be scanned and everything and then put on the shelf at the back of it to get painted.
But then there's only a small subset of that that then actually turn into what we'll put on the race car.
Looks like an F1 car to me.
I do PR, not engineering, but it looks cool.
Yeah, so over here is test and validation. This is where we prove out the strength of the full-size car park.
This was it. This was the R&D department. When I joined, that was it. But we've gone from that to all of this in less than a year. And then if we just wander down here, you're going to have to check this because I'm not sure how much you can show people. So that bit, that's basically a prototype bit of chassis. It's about to be loaded to 30 tons. And then that team of people that you're looking at over there are a combination of designers, stress engineers, test engineers. It's not quite as simple as just put 30 tons on. You're going to get a load of information out of it. This isn't the first time it's been loaded. It's been loaded several times before. There you go, that's one bang. So then I check to see what's happened. That was a big bang. To me, that sounded a bit of a glue failure. If it's a big failure, it's more of a thump than a bang or a crack. No one wants to see anyone have a, if you like, get hurt on Sundays. And that's what all of this is about.
We've just pulled up to the Silverstone Museum. Pretty stoked to check it out.
Let me take you through. Silverstone started as an airfield in the RAF during the Second World War were based here. When the RAF disappeared, there was a lovely perimeter road around the airfield, which people started racing around. It's gone on ever since from there.
I've worked in motorsport for 54 years. I've been there in the days before teams were enormous and when there was just one PR person. We need to make it about people, not just, let's say, two cars on the grid.
Yeah.
It needs to be how they got there, who put them there, the passion. You know, these guys, they're not doing 40-hour weeks. They're in there at 7 o'clock in the morning and they're going home at 10 o'clock at night. And the pride when those two cars are on that grid, there'll be a lot of tears. I hope you'll be there to capture the tears, but there will be. That's wonderful.
We just wrapped up filming over here. And now These guys are building the garage for the first time. They're gonna be testing it, making sure it's all good to then get thrown into these boxes. And then it's gonna start traveling all around the world.
Is it the only time that all the sea freights and air freight will be in together in one location?
Yeah.
Once they start to leave, that's it, they're gone.
Wow.
They won't see each other again.
So you're starting to ship in November?
We'll start the ship for 2026 in November. Fire extinguishers, garage fans, drip trays, garage build equipment, hospitality unit, coffee machines, consumables cabinets with all like the oils everything. And lubes and everything. So it's just copious amounts of kit that we just send out around the world.
All the buildings on this campus have ramped up so quickly. You had to probably sign the leases on these well before the bid was officially accepted.
First, I will say it was a huge amount of pressure, if I'm being super honest. To show that you have what it takes in Formula One, you do have to build it first.
And that's one of the things that I know was looked at in terms of commitment. We have earned the ability to be on the grid, and we have earned nothing more.
We can't magic something up. What we can do, get the right people together, whether they're designing a component of minimum weight, or whether they're designing aerodynamics of the floor of a Formula One car, or whether it's the driver. It's the people that make the difference, and it's the people that make fast.
Anything keep you up at night?
Most of it. You're always thinking, you know, where the extra bits of performance are going to come even once you built it.
We're building a team of the future. We're not just here to copy and replicate what somebody else has done. And again, we're here to race and we're here to win.
That's our Silverstone episode. The picture is getting painted for us in real time as we continue to film this story. We will see you in the next episode.
I'm sure I'll look at it and think it's not good enough and there'll be stuff I want to make better quickly. But yeah, doing the first car for a new team is brilliant.